this evening's question and answer session of the school committee candidates, which also includes the council president candidate, is being sponsored by the Fort and Cummings parent-teacher organizations, as well as the high school parent-teacher club. We all felt very strongly that the school community needed an opportunity to get to know the candidates, and we had done this a couple of elections ago, and it was very successful, and we wanted to give it another go. So we'd like to thank the candidates for joining us tonight, thank the folks at home for watching, as well as the people here at the Cummings in the room. So we received an overwhelming number of questions from the school communities. We had sent out emails as well as social media posts asking for questions. And what we did is synthesize them and try to come up with themes that we could present to you all tonight for your answers. So just as a welcome, we have Mr. Craig Mail, Laura Callis, Tino Capobianco. Marcy Moline, Jared Wickham, and Ron Vecchia. Unable to join us tonight is Chris Hurley. He had a professional commitment, and council president candidate Bob Driscoll had a prior engagement and is unable to make it. So we are sad about that. Unfortunately, they just couldn't get out of what they had. The format for this evening is as follows. Each candidate will have 30 seconds to give a brief introductory statement, and then from there we'll pose a series of questions. The candidates are going to have 60 seconds to answer each of the questions. We have predetermined the order prior to the event, and we'll stagger the starts after that first round. We'll also have a speed round in which the candidates will have an opportunity to quickly, in one or two words, answer a statement. We understand that no one or two words can completely get at a person's sentiment on a particular topic, but we do want to encourage the candidates to do their best just to give us their position on particular topics, and you'll see where we're headed with that one. And then finally, the candidates will have 90 seconds apiece to close with closing remarks. We will monitor time, as we talked about before the event, and Erica will be the timekeeper. I will be shutting you down at the allotted time, so please don't think of me rude. It's just we need to get through this evening. So without further ado, one point just to let everyone know is, and when we selected the order, Mr. Vecchia is actually second in the order, but due to his foot issue, we had to seat him on the end. So we will be flipping back and forth to make sure that he maintains his order in the lineup tonight. Okay. All right, great. So we'll start with you, Craig, if you would.
Winthrop Studies Day, Chromebook purchases, increased parenting programs, Khan Academy, a solid IT background, and keeping ahead of IT issues before we fall behind, a discussion on wage parity, early childhood modeling, understanding the school budget, Genius Bars, learning portals, and a participant in the school process for the last 4 years are some of the items that I have been highlighting on my Facebook page, Craig Mail for Winthrop, and that have been part of the defining goals of my time on the town council as a member and now as a town council vice president.
Thank you. Laura? Ron.
Thank you.
Good evening. Thank you for those who put together this program tonight, and it's great to see so many people attending. It shows the interest in education in Winthrop. Most of you may know me from my recent appearances on WCAT with my show, but a lot of you may know me as a former selectman in the town of Winthrop. I've held various boards over the last 40 years, very actively involved in the town that I care about. So I want to bring that experience to the board.
Tina.
My name's
My name is Laura Callis. I am married to Matt Callis, who's a candidate for Housing Authority. He's a third generation Winthrop resident. I'm a former high school math teacher with Boston Public Schools, and I'm currently working on my doctorate in mathematics education at Boston University. And I think I'll stop there before I get the fingers.
My name's Tino Capobianco, and I'm running for school committee because I want to give back to the community that made me who I am today. I'm a fairly recent graduate. I graduated Winthrop High School in 2007, where I was a student athlete, class president, involved in many organizations. I graduated from Suffolk University and later went on to work for Speaker of the House, Bob DiLeo.
Marcy.
Hi, my name's Marcy Moline. I am a proud parent of two great, amazing girls here in Winthrop Public Schools. I've become involved in the town through various education activities, but most recently I was the chair of the Winthrop is Worth It Committee, and I'd like to continue my service for the town and I'm very nervous, so I'm going to continue to be nervous, but I promise you that I will certainly study up on issues and try to be fair and balanced for the town. I want only the best. Thank you.
Jared.
My name is Jared Wickham, and I bring a unique educational perspective to the table, having been a paraprofessional here in Winthrop, a special education teacher at the primary and secondary levels, and a current special education administrator. I understand the needs and the wants and expectations of students, teachers, and administration. I understand the reality of schools, and I am an advocate for change here in Winthrop, and I'm an advocate for the children here in Winthrop. Thank you.
Great. Thanks, everyone. Okay, so we're starting with Mr. Vecchia for this first question. And just as a reminder, you'll have 60 seconds, and Erica will give you the heads up. What do you see as the school committee's role and responsibilities, and how would you describe an effective committee member? Please describe your personal experience and involvement with the public schools in the past 5 years that qualify you as a school committee member.
Well, I guess my background just being involved in town government is a big plus. As a member of the Board of Selectmen, years on the board, we've always supported activities at the school relative to budgets, relative to debt exclusion overrides and so forth. I was on the school building committee for this very building here, and also the Fort Banks Gorman School. I've done countless programs on WCAT when we were asked about voting for this new school that we're now currently building. I did countless programs with the educational folks to promote the reasons why we were worth it in Winthrop to have a new school. Just my experience alone in town government, I've been involved in so many activities on the Board of Selectmen, whether it's collective bargaining, negotiations with mitigation packages, and I feel it would be a great asset to the board.
Thank you. Laura, do you need me to repeat the question? Or are you okay?
I'm sorry, I'm confused about, okay, so I'm next. Thank you. I think the role of school committee is to advocate for stronger schools. That includes both the social and the academic side. And so for the social side, that includes both sports and extracurricular activities, but also making sure that we have the strongest academics possible. My involvement in the schools, other than being a high school math teacher, I also worked with an organization called Breakthrough Cambridge, which mentors college students to teach middle school students, and I help them learn how to teach math. I also worked for MIT in an outreach program to get more students into their mathematics program, so I know a lot about working with kids. In addition, I know I can bring expertise in professional development for teachers and knowing what works in other school systems across the country from my studies at Boston University.
I believe that the primary focus of the school committee is the hiring and firing of the superintendent. We also approve the pupil personnel's director. We also hire the school committee attorney, and we monitor the budget. The school committee also pays dues to the Massachusetts Association of School Committees and Massachusetts Association of School Superintendents. I look forward to working with them. In the past 5 years, having worked in the speaker's office, I represented him and attended meetings with the Massachusetts School Building Authority regarding the new middle high school. I was at the table with former Treasurer Grossman. I was at the table with Catherine Craven, who works for the School Building Authority. And I'm excited to get to work if you vote for me on Tuesday, November 3rd.
The role of the school committee is really to do a lot of the legwork in terms of getting the best, or a lot of the administrative legwork. We have our teachers that are teaching our children. We have our administrators that are keeping track of the numbers, keeping track of the test scores. But our role is to try to make us succeed and use our resources that we have whether for my background, a higher education background, also at Boston University in the School of Medicine, or using the resources that we have for our community. A lot of people who have worked with me from like the Winthrop is Worth It 2.5 override that is now currently building our school know me for the person that spent all the, and I'm just going to crash and burn here tonight. Thank you.
And Jared.
We hear a lot of answers to what the school committee's job is, but in the end, it's about the students. It's about providing services, staffing, and budgeting to give the students the best education possible. My background is strictly for the kids, whether it's helping to build MCAS training in the Everett Public School System, whether it's building and maintaining a life skills program for our special needs students, or whether it's working with other staff to develop proper co-teaching methods to build relationships in the school, which in turn benefit the kids. That's where I stand. There are a lot of little pieces of school committee. We all have to learn them at some point. But in the end, it's about the kids. We have to give them the best possible education, the best school environment, the best testing policies, the best teachers, and the teachers themselves need the best development to be as good as they are. We have an excellent school system. We have incredible teachers. But someone needs to come in there and make the changes to make it that much better.
Great. Thank you. All right, the next question. Oh, sorry. Mr. Mann.
I hadn't answered the question.
Oh, my apologies.
That's okay. One of the unique elements of being here tonight is the fact that I am running for the office of council president, and in so you become a member of the school committee, and the school committee, of which you're a member of, certainly has the roles that each one of these candidates has spoken about. As the town council member of the school committee, I look at it as bridging the gap between the town and the schools, trying to move us closer together. I think that one of the biggest issues that you face as a town council president is the budget. It's certainly one of the bigger issues that you face in education overall. And I think one of the things that I was able to do this year is ask the finance portion of the schools to break out their budget between their foundation budget and their programming budget. And what I would like to be able to do is look at the programming budgets over the next couple of years and find a way to get the advanced programming that we need in the schools for the teachers, for the students, and to raise the bar overall so that we have a better school system.
I promise I'll get the order right. Okay, our next question, and Laura will be starting with you. Please describe your experience with budgets, contract negotiations, and conflict management.
Oh, excellent. So conflict management, I worked for Boston Public Schools, and there was plenty of conflict in my classroom. I think that I had to work really hard at building relationships and building community among people that didn't necessarily like each other, and they were teenagers, so I had to help them see from different perspectives, which didn't always come naturally. And then in terms of budget management, is that right? Thank
yes.
you. I was an assessment manager at a nonprofit that provided assessments and data analysis for schools. I managed the development of the math assessments, and through that I had to contract with other consultants to develop these assessments and manage our budget. So I had to be very careful, since it was a nonprofit and we were using schools' money, about how I used that money and how I could use it the most effectively.
In terms of budget, I think I have great experience, again, having worked at the State House, having no direct family in the school department. There aren't any votes that I could recuse myself from in terms of budget. I think we need to invest in our children's education. We need to build and increase finances for the schools. We can't build on the future of education without proper funding. We need to work with the town manager. We need to work with the town council by convincing them and demonstrating why we would need increased funding, and maybe sometimes even use some free cash with the town. When we continue to strive and increase our test scores, I believe that we need to keep our teachers here. Last year we had a turnover of 60 teachers. I think that's unacceptable. And when our teachers strive, so will our students. I think that's unacceptable. And over the next few years, our great teachers should stay here and have an increase in salary.
Okay, regarding budget, I spent over 14 years working for the Continuing Medical Education Office at Boston University School of Medicine. When I joined, there were only six staff members that were working there, and I was part of the finance team in all for this office, where we grew it to over $1 million towards the end. We're now a kind of like they call it a for-profit center now within the nonprofit at Boston University. I've since left that position and have now taken on a new challenge, where I work for a not-for-profit genetic medical laboratory. And with that, when I came on board, we had an entire turnover of staff, and I've since now extended the lives of, I think, pretty much everybody there at the staff. So I think teamwork and developing a collegial relationship within the schools here at Winthrop is important.
Jerry. Conflict management is something that I have to deal with, unfortunately, on a daily basis as an administrator. I deal with conflicts between teachers, conflicts between students, and conflicts between staff. The way to approach any conflict is to mediate, to see where the problem lies. There are two sides, and then there's the truth. And that is how everything in life works. I have no problem speaking my mind and making it clear that we cannot have conflicts. As far as contract negotiations, 3 years ago, I was on the public school system working on the contract negotiation team. It's not a fun process, as anybody who's been involved with it knows. However, I would speak up. I always speak up. If there's something that needs to be done or needs to be changed, I will say it. I will fight for it, and I will defend it. And with budgeting, I've worked with budgets on special ed. I've been able to bring back over $500,000 per year using work with the MassHealth, using work with the state. I understand where money has to go. I understand how we have to find it.
Craig.
Could you just repeat the first, because you had 3 points, I only picked up two.
Sure. Please describe your experience with budgets, contract negotiations, and conflict management.
You know, one of the first things I think about in conflict management is not how you handle the conflict, but how you prevent them from happening in the first place. And I think it's very, very important that we start to look, because conflicts come from two sides, and we have to find solutions to those problems. And I think it requires a very, very close relationship with the people that you may have those conflicts with. Makes it a little bit easier over time, and I found that to be very helpful on the council. On the budget is something that I have prided myself on and working with over the last 4 years. The first year I sat through the budget process, I sat there and watched as a couple of people seemed to know every element of the budget. And I sat there in amazement when I heard people on the Citizens Finance and the figures that they knew. And I worked hard over the last 3 years to get up to that level, but not just to understand the expense side of the budget, to understand the revenue side of the budget. And that's why this year, when the school needed a special reading teacher, I asked that that money come from the revenue side of the budget, that it not affect anything else. It wasn't passed at that time, but I think my understanding of the budget will enable me to bring things forward in the future.
Imran.
My experience, again, as chief executive officer of the town, as a member of the Board of Selectmen, I've dealt with budgets for 9 years. It's a task that takes a lot of communication with departments, prioritizing where the needs are and so forth. I would use that experience as I develop and work with a budget for the school department. Conflict management, I kind of go along with Greg in trying to avoid that if all possible. So your relationship with your employees, your relationship with workers within the community is very, very important. As far as the collective bargaining, I've been involved with that with police, fire, and DPW with my experiences on the Board of Selectmen. So I've seen all these different areas on a different side, and hopefully I'll be able to look at it on a school side, and that's one of the reasons I'm running.
Okay, on to our next question. Tino, you'll start. Teacher retention can often be a challenge. How would you suggest improvements to retain teachers on a budget that does not allow for monetary incentives?
It's a great question. What right now, a lot of problems, a lot of kids my age start out as Winthrop teachers are going elsewhere. That's because we're increasing their salary. We're not increasing their salary. I think it's very difficult to keep teachers here without increasing their salary. Quick example. when I was a sophomore, I struggled in math. I had 4 math teachers my sophomore year during Algebra 2. It took multiple times for me to pass the MCAS. My parents took control of it. I had a private tutor, but my last teacher that year, Winthrop Grill, 23 years old, Harvard grad, she's the reason I passed the MCAS. We couldn't keep her here. She went elsewhere. And I think if we gave her a little bump in salary, she would stay here and she'd be doing teaching other generations how well she did for me. Because of her, I was prepared for college.
Marcy, can you repeat the question, please?
Sure. Teacher retention can often be a challenge. How would you suggest improvements to retain teachers on a budget that does not allow for monetary incentives?
You know, I think if we can't have the monetary incentives, there are so many things that we can do, which is like, for example, creating a team atmosphere amongst the teachers, allowing for perhaps them to have more time to plan for classes and to have time in amongst themselves. We also have in our community here quite a few people that, you know, they work for the universities and all here around us. There are during my time in the PTO, we were able to find people that live here and also just people from the area that are willing to come into the schools to talk to the teachers and to help. So I think developing some sort of transparent communication amongst the teachers will promote a team atmosphere amongst them and want to have them remain.
Jared?
Look, everybody wants more money. It's a reality. And some places have it, some places don't. It's the nature of the game. Yeah, I tend to believe you know what you're going into when you go into something. Obviously, in a perfect world, we give everybody all the money they wanted, but we don't have that. So you're right. The question becomes, how do you keep them in a school system with wonderful kids and a wonderful community? You boost morale. You put them in a place where they feel like they're part of something, where they're making a genuine difference in a child's life. You do that through team building, as Marcy said. She's absolutely right. You do that through professional development, to give them the skills and tools to make them better educators for the children so they can see higher quality results. When you see a high result in a student, as you do with your own child, whatever it is you did to get there, you feel good about. And that alone will keep people in the schools. It's not always about the dollar. It's about the end result. And if we can give them the things they need for those results, they will stay.
Craig.
In my earlier remarks, I brought up a comment on wage parity. And it's something that I think I've spoken about recently at the town council, in the sense that I think Winthrop has reached a tipping point where all individuals across all age groups and all length of times in the town are going to have to sit down and have an honest discussion on who we are, what we are, and where we want to go. The fact remains that the school average state school budget is about $14,100, and the current budget in Winthrop is about $11,600. And in almost every one of the metrics, we are below. And we're going to have to sit down and decide that. I think it's difficult to make people happy. It's difficult to give programming. It's difficult to do teamwork when you don't have that budget. So I think it's time for everybody to sit down. Same thing I ask that we sit down on Miller Field. Let's come down and have a strategic plan that we can move forward on in the future so that we're successful with where we're trying to go.
Ron. I would agree with some of Greg's remarks. You know, let's face it. We have a brand new school that's being built. Okay, we have 2 schools, this one in the Fort Bank School. We have the facilities. The town has got to step up. The community has to step up and say, what do we want? Do we want better education for our kids? Do we want to be committed to the teachers that teach our kids every day? You know, we're in the bottom 10% in the state for pay for teachers. That's not good. Okay, that's not a good incentive for a teacher to come and want to stay in Winthrop. I think over the last 5 years, we've lost 60 to 65 good teachers left, whether it was for pay or for other reasons. That's not a good track record. We have to take a hard look at it. The town has to step up and make a commitment to the price of education in the town.
Okay. So I agree with a lot of what has already been said here. I'm a homeowner in Winthrop, a new homeowner, so I understand the pressure to not raise taxes in order to pay for higher salaries. But the reality is that you can't expect people to stay here if they're making $15,000 less than their neighbors next door. So definitely teacher pay is important. But like others have said, having been a teacher, the reason that you stay is not necessarily only because of what you're getting paid. You have to feel like you can do your job. So I left because I would get into fights with my colleagues about who broke the copy machine. And I felt like I didn't have enough books for all my students. And I felt like I wasn't successful because of all these systemic things that were wrong with Boston. So those are things that we can fix that don't cost the same amount as raising salary, even as we want to raise salary. We can also make it more reasonable to live in Winthrop. We can do mortgage deals. We can start thinking about creative childcare solutions. We can think about better ways to make it possible to live in Winthrop on a teacher salary.
Thank you all. Our next question, we'll start with Marcy. Boston Magazine recently ranked Winthrop 99th of the Massachusetts public school districts inside 495. This is in the bottom 25th percent and is based on MCAS and SAT scores, graduation and college attendance rates, average class size and student-to-teacher ratio, and per pupil spending. Can you comment on what you will do as a school committee member to improve the performance of Winthrop Public Schools in these areas?
Yes. First off, I have a big problem with like these ratings that people come out in Boston Magazine and U.S. News and World Reports, and you know, rating the schools, because they go by one metric. One of the things that people in this town, I don't think, or these publications don't measure, is the amount of community, the amount of love within this community. You know, we saw this love when, you know, when baby Doe was lost. And I think with that, we can work on these changing these things from a community level.
Whether you like it or not, education is based on numbers. That's it. Money is based on numbers. Money that comes in is based on numbers. Everything is based off a number. It's not the best solution, but it is currently all we have. MCAS scores, whether you like the test or not, are there for the foreseeable future. So we have to get used to it. We have to just accept it and adapt to it. I look at some of the scores. They recently just came out this last round. And Winthrop has made some improvements. And the teachers alone should be commended for that. However, there are always areas for improvement, and we need to address how to do that. That is how you increase scores. It's not by blaming people or pointing the finger, it's by saying, how do we fix it? You fix it with meaningful and effective professional development. You put the teachers in an area where they can learn from professionals for extended periods of time, and where to start with the children from K to 12, because kids will retake the tests. They learn the skills to build the ideas, and they can solve the problems, and our scores will go up.
Great.
One of the things that I have talked about is looking at how we look at our revenues overall. Another thing that I thought would be a good idea is to put more road education into the one-on-one and start children off earlier. In the younger school this year, we had 150 kids come in. We had about a third of those come in from a day school in the area, which gave us some understanding of what those children are. I think one of the plans that we could do for a relatively reasonable amount of money would be to get the other two-thirds of the kids so that we have an idea of what kids are coming into our school so we can start to program. And then we can start to advance that through one-on-one learning, through things like Khan Academy and other programs like that. But it's going to take a sort of a paradigm shift to move some resources down to that area. But again, if we sit down and we discuss how we want to do this, I think we have a better chance of moving the ball forward.
I think it's important that, you know, the kids that are struggling with MCAS, there needs to be an emphasis, whether it's a separate program that these kids are put into so that they're giving the help that they need to bring their MCAS scores up. I think that's a contributing factor to the overall drop in a score. The other thing is the good students, the students that are bright. In many cases, they don't want to stay in Winthrop, and maybe they leave Winthrop. So now you have a balance that's really not there, that the brighter students may decide for one reason or other to leave the system, and now we're, you know, you're taking the total on an uneven seesaw, if you will. So I think that, I think professional development is very, very important with the teachers. I think the teachers will sharpen their skills. The teachers should be challenged so that the teachers can challenge their kids as well.
Okay, so I think this issue is a reason why we really need somebody who knows about teaching and testing, which I think I do. We need somebody who knows that whether or not it works to actually separate out kids to be leading some of these decisions. And I think that we also need to take a look at where we are right now and what our assets are. So our teachers and our students have really good relationships with each other, but I'm also hearing from parents that the expectations aren't high enough, that the expectations have even dropped in the past few years. So I think that we need to think more about how to capitalize on the things that we're good at, like teacher-student relations, but also to beef up where we're weaker. And I think knowing that we've lost so many teachers and we have a lot of young teachers, we need to be thinking about teacher knowledge and how good they are and how good they feel at teaching mathematics and at teaching English and reading and all the four core areas. So I think that's where we need to go if we're going to really improve our schools.
There are studies right now, and some folks in the educational world are taking a look at maybe standardized testing should not be a graduation requirement. 60% of students who pass the Mass MCAS still need help with remedial math when they go to college. Take a look, you want to talk about Winthrop? Take a look in the lobby of Winthrop High School. Take a look at the acceptance letters. We have two students in recent years went to MIT, Harvard, Suffolk, BU, all the schools you could imagine. We have great kids. We have student awards. We have one of the best drama programs there is. We have a girl that was a senior when I was a freshman who's now on Broadway. We have banners throughout the school. And take a look at your football player, your senior, walking around, who's volunteering to win our kids and helping them zip up their flies. This is a great community, and that poll means nothing to me.
Jared, this one will start with you. Currently, very few resources are focused on retaining the brightest students, with only advanced placement classes offered in high school and advanced math in the middle school grades, yet very little at the lower levels for high achievers. Do you think we lose some of our best students, including, and perhaps tellingly, the children of teachers in our district, to private school or to, quote, better public school districts? And if so, what would you like to do or change to retain the brightest students in the school system?
I think that in any school system, the biggest, the brightest kids are going to be enticed to go elsewhere. And that has nothing to do with Winthrop. I think that when you have a student that is exceptional, whether it's in athletics or academics, people want them. And parents want to put them in places, private schools, places where they're guaranteed things or promised lofty dreams. The reality is that we have great kids. We're always going to have great kids. And we have to maybe in some sense incentivize them to stay. It's not the best thing in the world, but maybe for the time being it'll work. It's something that you need to make a whole plan about. You can't, unfortunately, give it a full complicated answer in 60 seconds, but it's a team effort. It's a school committee's team effort. But you start with incentivizing them. Give them a reason to be here, whether it's scholarships, substantial scholarships, guarantees, athletic scholarships, academic scholarships. Give them financial reasons to stay, because in the end, it all comes down to money.
Thank you. Craig?
You know, when you talk about incentivizing children to stay in the system, that can be a very difficult situation. But one thing Winthrop does have is we have the largest, to my knowledge, scholarship program of any school in Massachusetts that I know of. I believe this year we gave out $250,000 worth of scholarships, including scholarships over $20,000. One of the things, and I know it hasn't been discussed too often, but I look at scholarships a little bit differently. Scholarships have always been used to reward children moving off to college. But what about the scholarship for the third grader who's a fantastic violinist or gymnastic person, or who may be having another skill? I think we can potentially start to look at the foundation and wonder if we can't move scholarships down to different levels. Just a thought that may work for us at one point in time.
Advocating for professional development of teachers goes a long way in sharpening their skills. You challenge the teacher in turn challenges the students. There's a lot of grant money that comes in to the system for kids that are struggling in education, but there's no grants that come in for kids that that are doing well. We need to take a look at it. We need to develop possibly new policy or a new program that would incentivize kids or just give them extra incentives to do better or to get more involved, whether it's outside work in the community, whether it's community within government or something, a project within government, to give them a sense of community involvement and a sense that they're part of something.
So I think that we have to think about motivation and the difference between intrinsic and extrinsic motivation. What we know about students who are gifted is they want to feel challenged, and that matters more to them than all the awards and stickers and scholarships in the world. And so if we don't have high expectations for them, then they are going to leave because they feel like they're not learning enough. So we need to be able to raise our expectations if we really want to keep the best and the brightest.
I know what it's like to be a student in Winthrop during our worst financial times. I was a freshman the year that we had the walkout during the override. I know what it's like to lose many friends to another school. I know what it's like to be sitting in a math class wearing a winter coat, being freezing learning. You want to talk about incentives? The new middle high school, these new beautiful buildings that we need to maintain, the possibility of a new Miller Field, the new drama area we're going to have, and our guidance department. I believe our guidance department is one of the best guidance departments in the state. Every day during lunch times, there will be a representative from various schools. And I'll give you one more incentive to stay in Winthrop. The idea of Viking pride, staying together as a community in the classroom, both on and off the field.
And Marcy.
You know, incentives for the brightest children. You know, I'd like to think that I have some bright kids, but I think part of it is also, it's not the children that leave the schools and leave Winthrop schools, it's the parents that move their children. So we need to make sure that parents are included in the communications and all. But then within the school, we need to make sure that the teachers, make sure that the teachers feel like that they want to participate in all in challenging the students. You know, there are opportunities for some teachers do provide the opportunities to some of our bright students by challenging them, by giving them extra work, giving them extra projects. When they hear about we're in the Boston metro area where there's so many great programs in the community and outside, that we can challenge some of these bright students and have them also reach into the community to increase their education.
We go back to Craig. Great. How should teacher performance be measured? How should the district balance using evaluations for accountability and using them to help teachers improve?
I think so much of that now relies on state regulations. I know in sitting through school committee meetings over the last couple of years that the town has instituted a variety of teacher testing models. And they've done an admirable job in moving towards that. But I think that all those things have to be continued. We have an interesting situation in the fact that we do test our teachers, we ask them to achieve, we test our administrators, we test our students. I think at a particular point, we may want to start to also provide some teaching and training to parents along the same level. I think that the models that we have are described, or at least are in place by the state, and we'll have to continue on with those. But I do think, from what I've heard, the school committee has done a good job in instituting that teacher training model and that teacher evaluation model. And that, I think, goes to the work of the superintendent and the people in his office.
Could you repeat the question?
Sure. How should teacher performance be measured? How should the district balance using evaluations for accountability and using them to help teachers improve?
Well, I don't know exactly what the process is now, but I think that evaluating a teacher should be based on the outcome, the students' scores that the pupils that she has or he has. I think that there should be input even from parents of the students that this teacher has in his or her class. I think it would go a long way to give an overall view of whether or not the teacher is achieving. I mean, you can look at the MCAS scores for that particular class and get an evaluation. I think that's how I'd approach it.
Okay, so with all due respect, from what I know about assessment, from working in assessment and from my studies at BU, if you make high stakes decisions based on student assessments, you actually invalidate the assessment because teachers will be teaching to the test, which means that students will be learning. So my friend Tino here has said that a lot of kids are passing MCAS and they're getting put into remedial math. That's because they know how to take a test and it's because they haven't learned mathematics. So I disagree that assessment should be used as a measure for teacher performance if it's going to be used for hiring and firing decisions. Also, I think we need to be using multiple measures. We have great student teacher relationships here in the school, and that's something that needs to be validated as well. I'd like to see us, even though there are state regulations that we need to be aware of, I'd like to see us move more toward a higher ed model where collective decisions are made based off of the teachers and parents and students and what they all view of the teacher's performance.
Unfortunately, at all levels of education, there is a bell curve. Half the class is over here, half the class is in the middle, and the other great half of the class is exceeding all expectations. So I think it's very tough to evaluate a teacher on test scores. And even as a student, there were teachers at all levels of education. I wouldn't like them, but the next year or the first college class, I thank someone like Mr. O'Connell because of Mr. O'Connell, I was prepared for that. So I think in terms of assessment, you could go to your team leaders and, of course, the administrators of the grade level.
You know, I have to agree on that. We need to use multiple measures, and I'm not at all behind the there's been a movement for paper performance, where the teachers get, by the number of students that pass, that they'll get an increase in salary with those incentives. I don't agree with those. I think we need to have multiple measures where we include not just the test scores but also the behavior, perhaps behavioral assessments within the class, whether there is overall improvement for testing, in their testing, but also, is there also clear communication with parents for the parents? But the things that haven't worked before have been setting it just to a test, and I don't think that we should do that.
Thank you.
Massachusetts has a new teacher evaluation model. When it's implemented properly, and it's been bargained properly by its bargaining committees, it's effective. It weeds out the teachers that don't do anything. It weeds out the teachers that don't stay past 2:30 to work with the kids to show they care. It works against the teachers that want to sit around and abuse tenure. They want to, after the first day of their fourth year, do nothing because they feel protected. The teacher evaluation system works when done properly. And I believe that student performance is directly related to a teacher, not testing, to the teacher. If the teacher can't reach you, you cannot be reached. If the teacher can't get to know you and take the time to know you, work with you, understand you, and see you from K to 8 perhaps in a school, then how can they build that relationship to see you go from step A to step B to after high school? We have to evaluate our teachers properly, effectively. We have to let them know that we will not stand for laziness. We will not stand for them to sit around and do nothing. They have to work with the students and for the students at all times.
All right, that does it for the Q
Q&A part, the official question with big long answer part. We're moving into the lightning round. We spoke of it before. So these are just intended to be quick hit questions because we got so many and we didn't want to leave some on the table. So obviously no question can be answered in just a word. However, we are looking just to get your general inclination for a particular topic. So I just want everyone to know that we're not trying to, understanding that of course there's obviously money involved or there's obviously some more behind it. So we're really just looking for a one or two word answer. Some of the questions are long, they're sort of set up, so but we'll continue the same moving format. So Ron, this one we'll start with you and we'll continue our order. School choice allows students from other school districts to attend Winthrop schools with their home district paying a fee to Winthrop. With the new state-of-the-art middle high school coming online next year, Winthrop will be a very attractive place for non-Winthrop students. Are you in favor of or against this program?
Against.
Okay, and then, sorry, Laura.
It's complicated.
Okay.
Yes, because I believe in opportunity and I believe in helping people.
Marcy.
It's complicated.
Okay, Jared.
Against.
And Craig.
I would say it's a complicated answer.
Great. So, Laura, this one starts with you. The current school committee requires the high school classes to obtain school committee approval for all fundraisers and activities, whether or not they are on school grounds. This poses problems if opportunities present themselves last minute due to the requirement to get on the agenda and timing of the meetings. Do you believe principals should be allowed more latitude on granting permission for these activities and fundraisers?
Yes, the principal should have that authority.
When I was class
one
president.
One more.
Oh,
speed round.
Yes.
Marcy.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. Jared.
No.
Craig.
Yes, I believe that would be acceptable.
And Ron.
Yes.
All right. Okay. Do you have children that do or did attend Winthrop Public Schools?
Starts
with
Tina. Oh. Nope. No kids yet.
Okay. Marcy.
Yes.
Jared.
Yes.
Craig.
My children do not attend school here.
Ron.
Yes.
Laura.
We will February.
Congratulations. Okay. Are you in favor of the project to redo Miller Field? Starting with Marcy.
Complicated.
Jared.
It's complicated.
Okay. Craig.
I have expressed a yes.
Ron.
Complicated.
Laura.
Yes, as long as it's not a line item on the school budget.
Tino.
Absolutely.
Okay. All right. Park or MCAS?
Who do we start?
Marcy.
Yes.
No.
Oh, sorry.
No, really, that was a multiple choice.
MCAS.
Jared.
MCAS.
Craig.
That's complicated.
Ron.
Toss up.
Laura.
Pro Common Core.
Tina.
Pro Common Core.
Okay. Does higher teacher pay correlate to better standardized test performance? Jared.
No.
Craig.
I don't believe so.
Okay. Ron.
No.
Laura.
Are they asking, like,
more money is better tests?
For the world? Or
for teachers.
Okay, well, in all the world of teachers, like the entire earth, yes, that's true.
So, no.
Marcy.
No.
Okay. All right. Do you favor technology investments? Craig.
Absolutely, 300%.
Ron.
Absolutely.
Laura.
Yes.
Tina. Yes.
Marcy.
Emphatic yes.
Jared.
Yes.
The school committee does not permit families to contribute to a field trip, yet the school only budgets $1,500, which often doesn't cover even the bus fee. Do you agree with the policy, or do you think it's okay to have families cover a portion of the cost, knowing that the PTO and PTC generally step in and ensure needy children are not left out? Rob.
You want that in a yes or no?
How about a sentence?
So what's the question?
The question is, do you think that children can be charged or should be able to be charged for field trips, or that the school needs to come up with a trip that only costs $1,500 so the kids don't have to pay?
So it'd be an option of a parent to contribute?
Correct.
As an option, not a mandatory?
Yes, but knowing that the PTO and PTC.
They should have the option?
Yep. Okay. Laura?
Yes.
Tina?
Yes, as long as a kid isn't left out.
Okay. Marcy?
Yes, so long as it's set on a sliding scale, like we've set it for school lunches, if they qualify for school lunch.
Jared?
Absolutely.
And Craig?
I would also agree with that.
Okay. One word, the future of Winthrop Public Schools. Laura?
Excellence.
Exciting.
Marcy?
Forward.
Jared?
Students.
Craig?
Technology.
Ron?
Forward.
All right, you guys did it. Yay. Okay. Thank you all for that. And so now we just want to give you all an opportunity for closing remarks. As I mentioned before, you'll each have 90 seconds and Mark will continue to do the time. So Tino, you get to start.
I'm running for school committee because I genuinely believe in giving back to the community. This town has really accepted me since having moved here in middle school from East Boston. This town made me who I am. Because of Winthrop, because of the school, because of the great teachers I've had, friends, coaches, you name it, I'm able to sit in front of you as a candidate for school committee. So on November 3rd, I'm asking for one of your three votes, and I promise you I'll be an independent voice that puts what's best forward for the students, teachers, and administrators of this town and this community.
Marcy.
You know, I learn from my mistakes. For example, I am learning I'm really bad at public speaking in front of a group here. But what I can promise is I am a really good study. I research, I get a consensus, I consult people. I learn about everything. Learning doesn't just start and finish in the schools, it continues into the school committee. And I hope to have the community members vote so that I can serve the community and continue moving us forward for the students. And I hope to have everyone's vote and just go to my Facebook page and all. I write a whole lot better than I speak.
Jared.
I can tell you about my educational background. I can tell you that I'm a fourth generation Winthrop school success from K to 12. And it's all fine and good, but in the end, it doesn't translate to effectiveness. I'm an advocate. I'm an advocate for the kids, not just because of my own, not just because of his friends, because it's all about them. I will speak for them and I will fight for them. I'm a teacher. I will fight for them and I will speak for them. And I'm an administrator. Believe it or not, I will fight for them and I will speak for them. My whole purpose, if you elect me to school committee, is to work for the kids. What's best for the kids. Beyond anything else, they're our future. They will dictate the world to us. They are the future leaders. They're the future captains of industry. And we have to fight for them, not against them, for the teachers, and not against them. So I look for one of your votes on November 3rd, and I will be that advocate that you need, and I will be the advocate for change that we need here at Winthrop. Thank you.
Great.
First, I want to thank the members of the PTO for putting this together. Don't clap, I'll lose time. Secondly, I just want to say, as a sitting town councilor, I've always been looking for young individuals that are IT savvy to come and join us on the IT committee, if you would. And I am personally thankful tonight to each of you, and I'm glad I'm not running for school committee because you've all done an excellent job. People have asked me what my presidency would be like if I am elected. While I have many goals and aspirations, my fundamental goal is to move the town forward in as many ways as possible. As a resident for over 60 years, with a family history much longer than that, we chose to stay here because we believe that Winthrop is a great place to live. I want to make it better. I spoke 2 weeks ago about Winthrop being at the tipping point. The road up the steep hill from financial problems to stability has been a long climb, but we're nearing the top. It's the people in this room and watching at home on TV, though, that will need to make the commitment to drive us the rest of the way. As parents of our youth, it is you who will set the tone for the future. What type of community do you want to live in? What are you willing to do to achieve this mission? I only ask that you join me on the road through your participation, your time, your effort, and your commitment. We're going to need to engage ourselves in conversation and soul searching to reach this goal. We need to balance the needs of all, but we can do this. We can make Winthrop all that it should be. I most humbly ask you to support me on this path with your continued support of my Facebook page, my time on the bridge, and when we meet on the street. Let's rejoice in the fact that in 40 years, when our children and grandchildren face the issues that face
I want to thank everybody for watching and coming tonight. And I just want to say that my life has really been about education. I've spent my entire life trying to figure out how to make schools better, how to get kids to learn more. And I'm really interested in putting all that I've learned to work for Winthrop because we live here and we want to raise our children here. But I also think I understand the complexity in ways that other people might not. And I understand how we have to be balanced. We are a small community. We have to fund these schools, but we have to do it in a reasonable way, and not, we're not Newton yet. So we will become Newton, but we need to think about how to get there.
I'm always last.
I'm sorry.
Is it because it's a V? Well, why am I running? It's interesting. I did a show with John Massaro on WCAT, and it was a walkthrough of the new middle high school. And I hadn't really given much thought about running for election after my last election in 2004. But when I went through the school, I got so excited about what was going to be available to the kids in this community. And I thought about my 7 grandchildren. So that's really the reason I'm running. I'm running because I'm excited for the youngsters in this community and the type of education they can get, the quality education they can get, because we now have more tools. We have a beautiful building. We have technology that we need to invest in. If I get elected, I can promise you that I will give it 1,000%, just like I have had the last 40 years in this community, serving on elected positions and volunteer positions. I'll continue the positive direction the school system is going in, with emphasis on improving MCAS scores, teacher retention, advocate for continued professional development of our teachers, advocate for continuing strong curriculum or extracurriculum like band, music, drama, sports. They're all very, very important in the development of a young person. Ensure the proper maintenance of the programs, a maintenance program within our school system so that we keep the investment that we've made. Support a plan to address our current and future needs as it pertains to Miller's Field. Vote for me. I'm the last one on the ballot, as usual.
Well, I want to take an opportunity to thank you all. This was really great. I'm hoping that everyone at home and in the audience got a lot out of it. I know I did. Thank you guys for coming out tonight. I wish you all the very best of luck. And to the folks who submitted questions, thank you, because I think it really shows how interested our community is in the seats that we have. And I wish you guys the very best. Thanks.
Thank you.